So at 20 feet, I see a pointy snout, a white underbelly, and a huge animal coming towards me. I realize at that moment that I'm now no longer swimming into a basking shark, but rather this enormous great white shark. We are in strong eye contact to one another. When you see a pigeon walking, it sort of reacts and then just moves. When you see a shark look at you, it sort of checks you out, looks you up and down, and just sort of seems to like size you up, and you feel like in this instant, you're like, wow, it just totally understands my physical abilities. I'm Keith Ellenbogen, and this is what it was like to swim with a great white shark.
What is the process of getting into the water with a great white, and why are you doing it?
Well, so I'm an underwater photographer, and I've been doing a project on raising awareness about our local marine life and from the Boston area. So that includes everything from the Gulf of Maine, which is Boston, up to Maine. And at this point, I was working really primarily within Stellwagen Bank National Marine Sanctuary. It's one of 15 National Marine Sanctuaries in the United States. You can think of it as a special place, like a national park. And it's right here, about 20 nautical miles off our coast. And there was one of these days, you've probably never experienced this, where you're out on the water and it's totally flat. Now, the sea in Massachusetts isn't always flat. There are a lot of waves, there's wind, things are a little bit more challenging. But on this day, it was very flat. And we were looking for basking shark. Do you know what a basking shark is?
Love basking sharks. Beautiful animals.
So a basking shark is this beautiful, gorgeous, giant shark, but it's a filter feeder. It feeds on plankton and our nutrient-rich waters.
Not a dangerous shark.
Not a dangerous shark at all. They migrate here from around the world, and they just it can be seen just with the fin just breaking the surface, swimming ever so slowly. So on this magical day where there's no current, no wind, seas flat, we see a fin on the surface. Now, I'm out with the NOAA Stellwagen Bank Sanctuary team. We were on a 50-foot boat called the Auk. And then from that boat, there were three of us who were on a little skiff. It was really a rubber inflatable boat. And we're just watching this shark move. And it's moving very slowly in a slow pattern, just straight in a line. And for about a half an hour, we watched it. And we decided, everyone confirmed, that this was a basking shark. Now, I'm looking for a basking shark to photograph because it's an iconic, great animal. And everyone goes, yep, it's a basking shark. So we position the boat pretty far away. I'm free diving, so I'm in a wetsuit, mask, snorkel, weights. And in this instance, I'm using a 360-degree sort of camera that can capture this as an immersive experience so that you would feel as though you're in with the shark swimming here. So I slip into the water pretty far away, mask, fin, snorkel, and I'm just sort of swimming towards a shark. Now, once I'm in the water, I can no longer really see the fin. So they're shouting out to me, go straight, swim this way, and I'm starting to go. The water at this time, because it was one of these beautiful days, and I'm telling you, it's not always like this, but because it was a beautiful day, you could see the rays of sunlight going through the water. It was like pillars. It was beautiful. And I mentally was changing my whole behavior. I was slowed down my breathing. I was preparing for capturing this image. Now, because we saw this shark swimming so slowly and then it made a spin on the surface, I thought I was going to get lucky this one day. And it's a known behavior where basking sharks swim in a circle and there may be a whole bunch of them. So my pre-visualization is I would free dive down, I would hold this 360-degree camera up, and all these sharks would be swimming around me and I would just be hanging out there underwater. So I'm continuing to swim. They tell me how to go. I'm getting closer. I'm about 50 feet. The ocean is gigantic. 20 feet away from the shark, I can still see the fin on the surface. I can't see the visibility is such that our nutrient-rich water, you can only see 20 feet on a good day, 10 feet on a not-so-good day, 0 feet on a terrible day. So at 20 feet, I see no longer what I'm expecting of this big mouth, open-feeding basking shark. But I rather see a pointy snout, a white underbelly, and a huge animal coming towards me. Now, just to freeze time at this 20 feet away, I realize at that moment that I'm now no longer swimming into a basking shark, but rather this enormous great white shark. And I really did the only thing that I knew how to do, which is keep my camera stable, and I sort of tuck my feet in and start to move. At 10 feet close, the ocean no longer is a big place. This shark is coming in right at me. I am so close at 5 feet away that I could almost reach out and touch it. At 2 feet away from the shark, we are in strong eye contact to one another. Now, when you make contact with a shark via your eyes, it's a very different experience. When you see a pigeon walking, it sort of reacts and then just moves. When you see a dog, it sort of makes an engagement. When you see a shark look at you, it sort of checks you out, looks you up and down, and just sort of seems to like size you up. And you feel like in this instant, you're like, wow, it just totally understands my physical abilities, right? So, and it must be embarrassing for myself. It must have said, oi, this guy doesn't know how to really swim.
Did it feel like it was trying to decide if you were prey or not at any point?
No, I think it just registers what was happening. Hmm. The shark was swimming ever so slowly. It's making extremely strong eye contact. At 2 feet away from the shark, I thought I was going to hip check it. Because remember, for a second, I was preparing to free dive down, hold my breath, and capture these images of the shark. So I had to like slow myself down, and I had to like push a little bit of water towards the shark. But they have these lateral lines which feel the senses in the water. And so anyway, at that very moment, the shark swims past me ever so slowly. It was swimming very slow, like a basking shark. And normally you would have an encounter that's 2 seconds, 1 second, shark would come in and move out. But in this instance, I have 17 seconds of where the shark comes in from where I could see it and just swims totally right past me and goes by. At the moment it continues on, I reach up to the boat, the skiff comes. I felt pretty strong at that moment, I have to say. I think I just pushed myself in and like literally just jumped right on the boat. And realize quite the encounter. And I think that at that moment, what I realize is that they get this perception that they're just wild killers, they're just out to get you. But that's really not the case out of it. I mean, I wouldn't want to swim up to one again. I certainly wouldn't want to do it in zero visibility or 20 feet of visibility. But I think it shows that they're predators, but they're not just wild man-eater kind of animals, and something to be appreciated and really greatly understood. Later that day, we had the shark identified. Dr. Greg Skomel, who you guys have interviewed before, ID'd it. It turns out that this was a known shark that was here, but it was the first time that it was sighted for about 4 years. Its name was Large Marge. They had identified it. We estimated it was bigger than the skiff that we were on. It's 17 feet and 3,000 pounds. Greg and his team estimated it was 17 feet and 3,200 pounds, so we'll take the bigger shark estimation. But either way, this was a giant, enormous animal to encounter. And I think one thing is that people have dove with sharks and been there, but when you can't see what's happening, 20 feet is a very close perspective, and a shark that's almost as big as the 20 feet is very close. It was what I hope is the only time that I ever see one close in that situation. And it was the only time that I think you'll ever get these very slow swimming up to each other encounters. So it was really just remarkable. And I'm convinced to this day that I'm the only living animal that has ever decided to swim up to a great white shark out of like just what it must have said is curiosity.
Yeah.
The other thing that I think is really amazing is that I could only see the shark at 20 feet away. But I'm sure the shark knew I was in the water at the moment I went in a couple hundred feet away. And so it would have known I was there, yet I had no idea until that encounter. It was really a special moment and a wonderful day.
Did you notice any behavioral change as the shark notices you and swims past you? Or was he just kind of doing his own thing?
You know, I'm not really sure what the... No, there was no change in the shark's behavior. It continued in the same slow trajectory. It must have been in some sleep-like catatonic state where it was just going slowly and swimming. I mean, there's no question its eyes registered. You can see it in the videos. No question, like, we looked at each other. But it just maintained this slow course and continued along on the surface. Maybe it came up from the deep and was sunning itself. Maybe it was just swimming on the surface. You know, I'll really never know what it was decided to do. But there was really no change even in the trajectory of where we were going.
You mentioned you were drifting towards the great white in this moment. If you wanted to or had to bail out, get back to the boat, was that an option for you?
No, I was swimming towards it. There was no way of knowing I was there. Mm-hmm. But now that you mention it, one part of the story that I did forget to tell is that from the surface of the boat, they could see that the shark, the angle of the pitch from being underwater versus on the surface, you can see a further distance from the surface. So they knew about 10 seconds before I did that I was going to encounter this shark. And I'm thankful to this day that they did nothing, that they just let the engine stay, that no one said anything or anything along those lines, and life just went by as it did. But there would have been nothing you could do in that moment. You couldn't swim, and the shark is a fast animal if it wants to be. No, I was committed to getting the image. So that part happened. And I think it's important to feel comfortable with the kind of animals you're going after photographing, because, you know, wildlife photography is about things happening in the moment, and you have to put yourself in situations to be able to capture those extraordinary moments, knowing that extraordinary moments happen. And so you can't see them if you're not in the water to go get them.
I mean, great whites, probably the most famous shark out there. Why should we care about their conservation?
Yeah. Well, sharks, and specifically great white sharks, are apex predators, meaning they're top of the food chain. And when you have a healthy apex predators, that means the lower animals are abundant and healthy there as well. And so we care to have apex predators because we care to have healthy marine ecosystems. And in all honesty, they're a symbol of a healthy ocean. They're, you know, wildlife has dangerous predators in there. But so we should care because they are part of that ecosystem. They keep animals in check and a balance. And by their populations being healthy means we have a healthy population here of other animals. And so it's a really wonderful thing. And sharks are captivated human attention from the dawn of time. They're an amazing animal. You know, it's remarkable. You can see a different fish. I never really understand this exactly, but when you look at a shark, there's a mesmerizing quality to it. It's just visual perfection in some ways. It glides through the water that is just such a beautiful swimming motion. It's unmistakably beautiful. And I think there's an appreciation to them and seeing it. And one other thing is that, you know, many animals react, but sharks seem to be in control. And I think just as a person with emotions, not applying emotions to it, but it must be nice to sort of care for things that are thinking through. I mean, I don't think it thinks about what it wants to eat in a day or how it's going through like we do, but I do think they have an ability in the ocean, and it's sort of nice to appreciate that tremendous talent that they have, which is a graceful swimming style.
Was this your first encounter with a shark underwater, or have you interacted with other species previous to this?
Well, it's never good for a great white shark to be your first encounter underwater. I'm an underwater conservation photographer, and I've been diving with many sharks over the course of my life, most all of them, from bull sharks to blue sharks to reef sharks. And so I think there's a level of comfort in getting used to animals first. And I think over time, as I took pictures and I got comfortable in the water and comfortable around them, you start to build your own skill sets up, especially from a photographic point of view, where you're using your art of how do you take a picture, capture an animal's sort of portrait in a way that hopefully gives people an emotional connection of especially something to care about. You know, over time, it built towards those things, and then free diving in the open ocean with larger free swimming sharks. So I had a level of comfort, I think, before all of this. To be able to just maintain a calm and sort of swim through and to capture those images at the moment. It would have been easy to feel like you want to swim away at that very second. But I think the important thing on all wildlife photography is always to maintain a composure, keep the heart rate slow, and steadily position yourself aesthetically for just the right moment to capture the image that you're after.
So such a stunning visual. This is an easy way to get people interested and pique their curiosity about shark conservation. When it comes to the conservation of marine animals overall, what other projects are you working on right now?
As we look to the future of like technology and how things are evolving and sort of growing, there's also an AI component to things. And so I've started to work with a partner, Andreas, who he and I have developed this project called LOBSTER. And it's spelled LOBSTGER. And the G is silent for generative. And what it stands for is learning oceanic bioecological systems through generative representations. So we are creating our own AI model. And that is training our model solely on images that I have taken so that they're authentic and that they are taken with accuracy of images from the Gulf of Maine. And then my colleague, Andreas, he is writing and developing all our own code. So we have custom code. We're not using any Google AI. We're not using ChatGPT or Elon Musk's Gronk. We've written all our own code. We're using all our own images, and we're creating our own model trained solely on the images that I've taken. So it has all the artistic and aesthetic properties that I work on as an image, and then added into that the AI capabilities. And so we're now generating photorealistic, high-quality images of these animals, and it's really fantastic. And so let me give you an example of how this might come into play. One of our animals is a Mola Mola. Do you know what a Mola Mola is?
I do, but I'd love to hear you describe it because they're wacky.
So a Mola Mola is a fantastical fish. It's the largest bony fish. And if I were to ask you to draw it or anyone to draw it, who knows what you would create? So if I showed you a picture of a Mola Mola, would you even be able to tell or know if that's a real fish or a fake fish? The question is, you may or may not know those kind of answers. And so if I showed you it, it's a large, enormous fish. It has a big dorsal and pectoral fin of it. So it sort of swims like this kind of with its top and bottom fins. It is sort of lacking a bottom back fin. So it sort of has a flat like little back fin. It looks sort of awkward and sort of ungainly on the surface.
They don't look like they should be able to swim.
They don't until they swim. And then they're gorgeous swimmers. Really beautiful. They can swim very balletically through the water. And so I've captured a lot of images of these. We've trained a model and we can generate beautiful AI-generated images. So through this kind of fish, people would look at it and may challenge their pre-existing assumptions. Is it a real fish or is it an AI-generated fish just out of imagination? In this case, it's a real fish. And just by learning that, they're learning a little bit about what is a Mola Mola informally, just because their own curiosity of trying to understand something. Simultaneously, we're trying to provide insights into what is AI. How do we think about AI? What are the images and some of the ethical considerations that go through this? Our model is trained exclusively on these images, and we know with 100% certainty, because I took those pictures, what the model is that was trained on, what the species was photographed, and how it should be represented. In other models that are large models, they're just scrubbing from the internet lots of pictures. And to some extent, they have the accuracy right, but they may not have it perfectly accurate. And so we're trying to sort of develop those images as a way to further enhance education and outreach about both AI conservation and images related to the animals in our ocean environment, especially in locally here off of the coast of Massachusetts and all the way up to Maine, to really represent the Gulf of Maine as an extraordinary animal. And we use lobster because I think there's no more iconic animal than the American lobster, and a symbol of both a healthy ocean, a symbol of a healthy, sustainable fisheries, and a sort of a symbol of like really ocean life in many ways. And so that has been the representation of that. And we use a little logo that we created on all our images so that people can differentiate between what is a real image versus what is an AI-generated image. But really, it's remarkable. And Andreas is one of the most talented individuals I know. And he's, you know, really been able to write this. So because it's all our code and all our images, you know, now we're at a point where we're really developing a larger model of this as our proof of concept is working well.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
Seeing species accurate depictions in AI isn't something that I've experienced yet. So that idea is very exciting. Do you see this as something that could be applicable to other areas in conservation?
I think it could be applicable elsewhere. I think we're starting here locally and building this up, and then we'll move forward into other areas as time goes on.
Keith, thank you so much for joining us. If you'd like to see more of Keith's photography and his other work, you can check out his website, keithellenbogen.com. And you can also see the show that he worked on, Space to See the Gulf of Maine Ocean Wilderness, playing in our Omni Theater. Keith, thanks again.
Thank you very much.